Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome back to a new episode of 2017 Championship Memories, part one of a two-part series. We look back on the 2017 Stanley Cup champion, Pittsburgh Penguins. Three members of that team joining us here today to discuss the memories and go down memory lane. We have Jake Guentzel, Matt Cullen, and Chris Kunitz. I'm Josh Getzoff from the Penguins Radio Network. Guys, thanks so much for taking the time being here. Hope you all are doing well, staying safe, staying healthy, and looking forward to talking to you.
Good to see you, man.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Doing good, thanks.
Yeah, happy to be here. Happy to discuss 2017, everything that came with it with you guys. But before we go into the 2017 season, I wanted to first go back to the end of 2016 in June as you guys celebrated your Stanley Cup championship at the parade. A couple of things that stood out to me, two things in particular, two lines said by your head coach, Mike Sullivan, and your general manager, Jim Rutherford, each of them saying something to the effect of, I think we can do this again next year. Now, it's one thing to say that to the fans in attendance and try to fire them up and hype up the crowd, but there seemed to be some calculated amount of thinking that went into those two saying that to the crowd. From the players' perspective, and Cooney and Cully, maybe this is more for you since you were on that 2016 team, did you guys feel like there were pieces in place to get back to the top again? I mean, there wasn't a whole lot of turnover with the roster, only a couple of players subtracted from 16 to 17. Coming into that season, did you feel like you had a group that could once again get back to the Stanley Cup championship?
For me, I don't think I actually thought of it like that. I try to enjoy the summer, enjoy what we did the year before. And then when you get there, I think the opening message from training camp was, we're going to try and do this again. And that's when it kind of clicked in, like, okay, well, we do have the same group. We have all these guys. We got the youth. We got everything we needed. We just got to make sure we can right the ship and start have that good start or get into it. But I don't think I thought of it until we actually started, day one.
Yeah, I probably agree with you, Cooney. Like, it was, obviously, once you win, it's, what is it, the middle of June, end of June, and, the summer buzzes by pretty quick with all the cup stuff. And so I think, like, probably when we got to camp, and it was kind of one of those deals where you look around and you're like, man, we almost have the exact same team. Pretty unique opportunity, especially in, like, the salary cap era when there's not many teams that are able to hold together, after winning. So I think going into camp, yeah, we probably all felt like, man, we got a pretty unique opportunity here. We got pretty close to the same group. And I think we got pretty excited once we got there.
And it was a short summer, Cully, as you mentioned, kind of warp speed coming out of the gate there with, as you guys remember, in September, the World Cup of Hockey was taking place. Your head coach, Mike Sullivan, was involved in that for Team USA. So he joined training camp late. It was kind of a different camp in that sense. And then, obviously, you started the season with a couple of doses of adversity. Both Matt Murray and Sidney Crosby not available to begin the season, which was kind of a theme as the year carried on with guys going down seemingly every other game for your group. But another theme that carried over from 2016 to 2017 was some of that jolt that came from the youth coming up in Wilkes-Barre. Now, obviously, in 2016, there were so many different guys that came up with Mike Sullivan, the Connor Sherrys, Matt Murrays, Tom Kunackles, Scott Wilsons of the world, Brian Rust. But then in 2017, there was one guy in particular that stood out, and he's one of the three on this chat right now, Jake Guentzel. Jake, first of all, when you got called up around Thanksgiving time in November, take me through that day, that moment for you and that experience. You made it count on your first shot. You had your first NHL goal.
Yeah, I mean, obviously a lot of nerves coming up for your first game, and you just see the team you have and the leadership in the locker room. I mean, it's pretty surreal walking into that locker room. So, but obviously just first shift, just trying to throw a puck on net, and I don't know how it went in. Definitely one you'll remember for the rest of your life.
Cully and Cooney, when you guys think back to that time in 2016 in November, what's your first impression of Jake Guentzel when he walks into the room?
Go ahead, Cullen.
I remember watching Jake. I probably told him that I remember watching him. I was playing for the Wild at the time when he was just a young little buck playing for the Hill Murray. What do they call you guys? Can't see the Hill Murray
Pioneers.
Oh, Pioneers. Yeah, you're not the Cake Eaters. But yeah, so it was fun for me. I mean, I knew I've known his dad for quite a while. His dad was one of the coaches that recruited me when I was going to college years ago. So pretty good familiarity with the family. And so, yeah, it was, I mean, it was cool to see him. You know, I remember watching him, like I said, when he was a little kid playing high school, and he still looked like a little kid when he walked in the locker room, but his game had definitely grown a lot. So it was cool. I mean, you know, being a guy from Minnesota, seeing more, you know, another young Minnesota guy come in, it's always fun. You know where he came from and who he is. And yeah, it was fun. I mean, I was happy, and it was obviously a pretty cool start to a career.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, watching somebody be able to come out and have success right off the bat, and bring that excitement and joy. You're obviously a sports fan at heart for all of us. So to see somebody have such such success early on is you know, something that you wish everybody can do. And as we know how hard it is, but a lot of guys can't produce that every time they come up and show what they can do and they get sent back down. But for Jake's cause, he came in and sparked everything.
Now, I'm pretty sure I recall hearing something along the lines of Marc-Andre Fleury saying that if Jake were to score in that game, he wanted everyone on the bench to stay seated, no one to stand up and celebrate. But Jake does end up scoring, and you can't help but notice the bench reaction of everyone jumping up immediately to celebrate. Why did things change there? Was it just the magnitude of how cool of a moment that was with the goal?
Yeah, that was supposed to happen, but I don't think it did. I think everybody was so excited to see that one go in. It was like all bets are off, you know?
Certainly that was a special moment all throughout the season. There were a few of them, and I think that's important when you look at a long grind of an 82-game campaign coming off an even longer season the year before that obviously culminated in the 2016 Stanley Cup Championship. So you need those little moments, bumps in the road along the way, I guess, to break up the monotony of a season. And certainly something that helps in that front is chasing history, which you guys had an opportunity to witness in 2017, as Sidney Crosby notched his 1,000th career point. It happened against the Winnipeg Jets in February of 2017. And another man on this chat happened to factor in on that, Chris Kunitz, scoring the goal for Sid's 1,000th point. Kuni, you were involved with a ton of those points that Crosby got in his career. What was it like being on the scoring end of his 1,000th, and what do you remember from that night?
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously an honor to be part of somebody's, you know, special moment, and 1,000 points is something well beyond a lot of us could ever achieve. So to be out there and character in on some of them, it was my 250th goal. I thought maybe I should have got the puck, but I didn't get any of it. So I know how sentimental Sid is. I thought maybe he'd cut me off a little slice of it, but I got nothing. So no, it's obviously a great honor to be able to go out there and find a goal on somebody's 1,000th point like that. But all jokes aside, he's done amazing things for every one of us who get to play with him.
Typical Sid, eh? Hogging the spotlight.
So obviously Crosby getting his 1,000th point is a big moment. So too was the time you guys went outside to play the Stadium Series game in February at Heinz Field against the Philadelphia Flyers. Now, Cooney, I know you were involved in a couple of outdoor games in your career. For Jake and Cully, this is the first time that you were able to step outside in your careers and play outdoors and everything that came with that, these special kind of events. And it was a special game, a 4-2 Penguins victory. Cully, you scored the game-winning goal in that game. What do you guys remember from that night in Pittsburgh, and how special of a moment was that when you look back on memories throughout the regular season?
It was fun. I'd always wanted to play in an outdoor game and never had the opportunity. So, when I saw that was on our schedule at the beginning of the year, it was one of those days that you kind of mark down as – something you're excited about and looking forward to, and watch these guys play. And, you know, Cooney got to, did you play in a couple, Cooney?
That would have been the third one.
We played
against Wash, and then one in Chicago. That was a cool one. It was snowing, but.
Yeah, that was cool.
It only took you to make us win one. That was the first one.
Yeah.
That's such a disappointment for all the buildup, but. They're obviously great environments and great events, like you call them, throughout the league. But I think what I remember from that one is just the drastic change in the weather. Like, I think we went out and played soccer, and it was, like, steaming hot. And we're like, oh, my God, is this going to melt the ice? And by the time the game came, there's little flurries coming around and snow starting to fall. And just playing your rivals, obviously, it's always fun when you fill the arena and everybody gets to share that experience.
Yeah, for me, I mean, it was just cool experience just to see the crowd and how many really people really showed up, and just brought back a lot of memories. So when you're younger, skating outdoors, and I mean, for me, it was just a lot of fun to have a chance to play outdoors like that.
Now, coinciding with the Stadium Series game right around the time of the trade deadline, and the Penguins did make a couple deals to bolster their defensive side of things. Ron Hainsey, Mark Streit coming on board at the deadline. First of all, Hainsey was an interesting character. From the media perspective, I feel like we only saw a little peek behind the curtain. I have a feeling, based on what I've seen, what I've heard, that Ron Hainsey was a little different fully behind the curtain in that dressing room. What was he like as a teammate, and how much did the dynamic of this guy who's played so many games in the NHL but has never been to the Stanley Cup playoffs ever in his career add to the, I guess, the desire to get back to the top within that dressing room?
Yeah, I mean, I think just his personality. He's you know, kind of a laid-back, old-school guy. Didn't really have too much exuberance in him, like whatever, but when he would talk, it was always, you know, a little shot here and meant something. And the closer we did get to the playoffs, then you started realizing, like, wow, this guy's played, you know, almost 1,000 games and he hasn't played in a playoff game yet. And that, for some of us, we take for granted. And when you can get to that point, and then obviously he became a huge part just to solidify our D zone and help guys, and you know, obviously scoring big goals when we get to the finals and things like that. But I think when you can add character people into a locker room, it helps every team.
Yeah, he was, I thought, like, he was better than I expected coming in. I mean, he was perfect for what we needed. I mean, he was great on the penalty kill, really good shutdown D, really good, like, calming influence in the room. He's a laid-back guy. He just didn't seem to, his heartbeat never seemed to get up at all about anything. But he was a great, really good fit, and just on the ice and off the ice. I mean, he just kind of came in and blended in. And yeah, and then, you know, as you learn the story, you get excited for him and you want him to win. And but no, I mean, he played some huge minutes for us down that stretch, and, you know, that entire time he was with us, he was a great add.
Another big component of the trade deadline was something that didn't happen. We all heard the rumors going around that Marc-Andre Fleury potentially could be dealt in 2017, and obviously there were teams that would have loved to add a goaltender of his caliber, but Jim Rutherford elected at the end of the day to keep Fleury on board in Pittsburgh, and that ends up paying dividends, as we found out later down the line. But for you guys, what did that do for the dynamic in the locker room, and also just the fact that you all of a sudden have two number one goalies, two world-class goalies at your disposal here coming down the stretch run?
I think that's, you know, a huge piece of why, you know, we ended up winning. Obviously having the Flower just in case there was injuries and battling for that number one spot when they go back and forth. But I think just his character, he's a guy that is infectious. Every day he shows up to the rink and he was smiling, playing games or competing after practice, playing these small ice games that we all like to do and competing against each other. And I think that would have really disrupted the locker room. I know it's probably really hard from a management side to hang on to somebody that's, you know, not going to be playing every game, maybe in their vision, and when they can see something happen. But I think, you know, obviously for us in the locker room was the right decision to keep them there. And good things happen when you have good people around you.
As a young guy, he's always talking, and he takes you right in, and he's just a super nice guy, and a guy that we all wanted around. So he came up huge for us, and like Cooney said, he's definitely a big reason why we won that year.
Yeah, I thought he was awesome. I thought it did a lot too. Like, it was kind of the elephant in the room coming down towards the deadline. Obviously that was what was talked about a lot. But just the way that Flower handled everything, obviously he's a potential Hall of Fame goaltender, and, you know, like, sort of a changing of the guard was going on and we all knew it, but the way that he handled it after the deadline and how much he gave to his teammates, I think when you talk about somebody that helps build a culture in an organization, somebody that's selfless like that, that's willing to step aside and just support his teammates. And then he ended up, like, playing a massive role. I mean, those first two rounds, he was unbelievable. I don't think we get through the Washington series if he didn't play as well as he did. He was unreal. So, yeah, being able to have two high-end goaltenders like that was, I mean, I don't think we win if we didn't have both.
Now, before you guys got into the playoffs in that series against Columbus, that series against Washington, the team was dealt a fairly big blow on the back end. Chris Letang, it was announced in mid-March, was going to be out for the remainder of the season. Neck surgery for a year that Letang unfortunately dealt with his fair share of time away from the ice due to injury. How big of a loss was that for you guys? What was the reaction within the room as the first part of that question? I guess the second part, Justin Schultz, Trevor Daley, Those guys really seem to step in and step up in the absence of Letang throughout that playoff run. What do you make of that whole dynamic as well?
I mean, obviously Schulte playing the way he did, obviously being a first line power play guy, really helped solidify what our D core could be and then help do it by committee. Obviously Dumo was a huge part of being able to take that over, and Colsey, I mean, they all did it. Specific things. Nobody can replace a guy like Letang on the back end who can move and eat up minutes like him. But I think they all grew their game a little bit. But Schulte, especially on that power play, be able to come in, and sometimes you get intimidated when you move in from a different team and you have to play with these superstars. But he wasn't shy about shooting the puck, and I think that's something that really kicked off our guys. And you know, everybody bought into the reason that everybody's going to be able to do this, and we're going to go four lines and, you know, seven, maybe eight D men are going to have to play. But it was something that, you know, helped us get through. Obviously missing a guy like Tanger is huge, but it helped everybody else step up and kind of solidify that they wanted to be there and prove something too, going into a back-to-back year.
Yeah, that's one of those things that you worry about how it's going to hit you as you, you know, get into the playoffs, missing Tanger. He was such a big part of the first run, and obviously he was just so good for our team. But it was like a good example of just like filling a hole by committee, you know, like Schulte was so good offensively. Dale's picked up a bunch of big minutes. Colsey was awesome. Mark Streit even came in. He played some good hockey for us even in the, down the stretch there. And obviously Ronnie Hainsey, like it was pretty cool how everybody rallied around it and sort of picked up the slack.
Yeah. I mean, it just shows how much the additions really helped us. And, there's a big committee thing back there when you have to replace Tanger. So I think everyone did a great job.
You guys roll into the playoffs. You match up against Columbus, a team that finished third in the Metro. You guys second in the Metro. And then game one comes along, and Matt Murray gets hurt in warm-up before you guys even drop the puck on the postseason. Marc-Andre Fleury steps in, which is kind of ironic because we talked last week with Jeff Zatkoff, who jumped in game one against the Rangers, Mr. Game One, as he calls himself. Stepped up in that situation. Marc-Andre Fleury steps up in a big way. And Cully, I think it was you who said to him, I was watching something from the 2017 championship video, that everything happens for a reason, as far as him staying with the team and then obviously having an opportunity to jump in game one. And did he ever seize the opportunity there against Columbus?
Yeah, he did. He played, I mean, like we talked about earlier, he was unbelievable in that series and the next one too. But again, it was one of those things where it was all year long, it was sort of the next man up mentality, guys stepping in to fill in for guys that went down. And, you know, obviously when you're coming off of winning the cup the year before, it's a lot of hockey. And like you mentioned, there's a World Cup that year. So not a ton of time to recover. So I guess injuries are expected. But that one right before game one was kind of a shocker to all of us. But to have Flower able to step in and just sort of calm everything down and play the way he did, it was just huge.
So you guys would obviously take care of Columbus in five games, but I think everyone remembers the third game of that series. After taking a 2-0 series lead, you go into Columbus, and that's when the Jake Guentzel show began. Hat trick, overtime winner in game three to end that game. But I wanted to ask you, Jake, what you remember about that game, that environment. That was your first taste of playoff hockey on the road. And what you remember about the goal itself that won the game with Sidney Crosby work behind the net and protecting the puck to find you in front.
Yeah, I mean, I think going into that game, you're not really sure what to expect in an away arena in the playoffs like that. And I was pretty in awe of how loud and intense it really was. And I think if I remember right, they scored maybe first shift or something, and the building was rocking. So it was definitely pretty intense for me. And I just remember Shears and Sid below the net, and they were doing their thing, and Sid's going back and forth, and I'm just trying to find an open spot, and just kind of snuck in the side door. And it was kind of a blur after that, because first overtime goal in the playoffs is a pretty cool moment.
Did you guys feel like, and I guess the Cully and Cooney, you guys can elaborate a little bit on this one, but obviously going up 3-0 in a series is quite an advantage, is a stranglehold. It's almost impossible, as we've seen historically, for teams to come back from that. But what did that win do for you guys in a series like that, where Columbus was just so physical, to get that opportunity to make it a shorter series and not let it extend as long as Columbus probably was hoping for it to?
Yeah, I think that was pretty important, just because of the fact that they were, you know, they're a physical team. That's kind of their trademark. They dumped a lot of pucks in. They you know, get in on the forecheck and finish checks on your D. So, you know, I think I've been in series in the past with other teams where you can see it take a toll on your D if a series like that stretches on. You get into a 6 or 7 game series where they're running your D all the time. I mean, they get worn down and it, you know, can add up to injuries. So I think it was important to get that series. Obviously that goal that Getzy scored was huge to get us that lead. And, you know, you never feel like the series is in hand, but obviously you feel like you're in a pretty good spot to close it out sooner than later. So, yeah, I think that was important.
So you win the series in 5 games, move on to face the Washington Capitals in round number 2, a rematch of the year before. And I think when you look back on the 2017 season, everyone kind of was hoping that matchup would happen again because of how much of a classic your series was in 2016. This one certainly lived up to the hype going the full 7 games. But I know you mentioned it a couple times in this game or in this chat we've had so far, that the play of Marc-Andre Fleury and how key it was to getting past the Capitals in this series. But also, you guys all contributed in your own different ways. Cully, you had the shorthanded goal in game number 2, a big one there for you guys as you kind of blew the doors off Washington and winning 6-2. But what was it about that series that maybe you learned a little bit about yourself? And when you talk about as things drifted on, I think it was game 3 when Sidney Crosby got the concussion. Connor Sherry, I think, also got hurt in that series. You were able to, you know, still get a 3-1 series lead. Washington comes back and ties the series at 3. You have to go in there and win a game 7. I mean, that had a little bit of everything.
Yeah, I think anytime you, you know, can eventually knock off the, you know, top team in the league, that for whatever reason, we always had Washington's number. But you never get to put them away. You know, there was always explosive moments, but we had those, you know, items or personnel on our team that could, make a game-changing save or make game-changing play at any moment. But I think once you get over that hump and once you be able to compete and finish those guys off, now you're just one of 4 teams left. And I think that's, you know, the hugest part is you kind of take another fresh breath even after a game 7. And it's like, wow, okay, we got 25% chance of winning this thing if we just go out and finish our next series and go on. But that second round against Washington, obviously you know, helps our team build, especially with missing different guys at different points and different guys stepping up, which theoretically we basically did all year. Somebody else kind of stepped up every time you needed somebody.
Yeah, for me, I mean, it was first time playing them in that kind of environment. And obviously a back and forth series. I mean, we go up 2-0 at the start, and then Crosby gets hurt, and we find a way to win game 4 to make it, and then they come back. And for me, I mean, I'm going to game 7 nervous, and just knowing that with the leadership group we have, I know we can get this done. And we were lucky to have Flower and Net, and we played, that was one of our best games of the year. And we just played good defensively and played our game. And obviously we're on top of that one.
Yeah, that's what I remember about that one. That game 7 in Washington was maybe our best game of the year. It was so fun. I remember throughout the series just thinking to myself, like, what good hockey this is. Hey, like, it was so fun to play, and the level of hockey, like, even just the fan and you came out at times where it was like, oh my god, that was such a good play. And there was just such good hockey on both sides. It was 2 really talented teams playing really high level hockey. I mean, I think back, I don't know that there's many series that I had more fun just playing the game. It was just such fun hockey and great plays on both ends, high tempo, physical, obviously a lot of hatred between the 2 teams. So it was really fun. And then obviously building into that game 7, you know, winning that game in Washington, I think that was huge for us going forward. But it was a really fun series to be part of.
Did you guys feel confident going into game 7? Because you had just lost 2 straight, including game 6 in Pittsburgh. And Washington obviously was you're probably feeling pretty good about themselves having erased the 3-1 deficit. Where were you guys at mentally going into that game?
I was nervous. I mean, first game 7. Don't really know what to expect. I mean, this is, you move on or go home. So I was pretty nervous, but you know what the guys in the team have done before and in their past. So I was pretty confident what we had.
I think we were pretty confident going in, even though we had lost 2 games, we had success in their building. And, you know, it's tough to beat a team three times in a row in the playoffs. And I think we kind of just snowballed all that and knew if we could play one good period at a time and everybody go contribute, that we would slow down kind of their effect and the pressure would be on them because they're at home and they're supposed to win and, you know, they're the top team. But yeah, I mean, we, like Cully said, I think we just played one of those perfect games where everybody did whatever they had to at that moment and that carried us through, and the clock wound down and Flower makes big saves and all those things, you know, kind of snowball each other, and the clock just kind of eventually runs out on them.
Yeah, I think that was one of those things that was like kind of one of the hallmarks of our group over those two seasons, was that whenever we needed a big game, we seemed to find our best, you know. And that was, and part of that too, you know, we've been through a lot as a group. We had played a lot of tough games and tight games, and you could kind of look around the room knowing that you're going to get the best out of everybody sitting next to you. So it was a good feeling as far as going into that one of confidence, knowing that, you know what, I'm pretty confident that everybody here is going to bring their best game. We'll be in good shape.
So you knock out a really physical, hungry Columbus team in round one, physical, complete team, I think it's fair to say, probably the most complete team you played all postseason in Washington in round two. And then you face Ottawa. What was the adjustment like going up against the Senators team in that Eastern Conference final that won game one in Pittsburgh, by the way? Obviously played a little bit more of a sit back and wait style. They seem to be very opportunistic, that when a turnover happened, they would capitalize. What do you remember about kind of adjusting to play them within your own game?
Yeah, I remember us, you know, maybe getting a little frustrated in that first game because we were used to that high flying, we'll dictate the pace and how we do this. And, you know, when they clog up the neutral zone like that and kind of keep you to the outside all the time, it makes it tough. And, you know, I remember their goalie being exceptionally well, you know, playing really well. He'd shoot 50 pucks and we'd come up with, you know, not many chances or whatever was going on, but then they'd come down and have a partial breakaway and score a goal. So the whole series, I think, was more mental than it was, you know, a physical grind like the Columbus or the Washington series. It was, you know, we can do this. We just got to keep doing it the right way over and over, and we'll have that success. And it was complete different styles. And, you know, for us, it took a little bit longer to figure them out and how we had to do it. But when we all bought it into the right thing, that's, you know, that's better games we played were those the reasons why, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't like a great matchup for us. It wasn't a team that liked to get up and down the ice like we did. So the mental side of it was hard. It was challenging. I think it wasn't like a lot of offensive opportunities. They really sat back and waited for you to make a mistake. And we were a team that liked to press the pace and push the issue a little bit. So it was challenging. I remember those first couple of games, it was like, man, you know, it's hard to come by opportunities here. You spend time in their zone, but you don't get any shots. And then all of a sudden, like Cooney talked about, they get a great chance off a bouncing puck or something. But they had a great goalie, and they were a veteran team, and they had a lot of guys that were just fighting, and they had a good thing going. You know, it was one of those teams that just got on a good run. And so it makes you nervous a little bit because it wasn't a great like matchup for our group, I didn't think. But we were able to find a way to kind of grind it out and find some patience in our game and get the win.
Game two, you mentioned some of the frustration that was settling in. One of the great clips from game two, Cooney, you were involved in when Phil Kessel is losing his mind on the bench. He's got the slamming down of the hands on each other, yelling at Toc. And then he scores. You're right there. And I couldn't help but notice when I watched the replay, you're laughing while you're celebrating with him. We've come to appreciate him, I think, when you look back on these championship teams. But moments like that, I mean, how different of a guy was he, and how much of a boost did he give your guys' team in these situations?
Phil was great for everything we could use. He was great in the locker room. He put guys on edge, but at ease, and he played big minutes for us, and he did exceptional things with the puck to maybe take some of that pressure off of Sid and the Genos that a lot of people don't maybe give him enough credit for. Like, his ability to go out there and be world-class in speed and shoot the puck is a game changer. And, you know, for him, he was more vocal. He loved to get into it a little bit, and he never shy away from saying what he wanted to. And so that was part of our job as line mates and teammates, is to, you know, help him reel it back in, but enjoy what we can all bring to the team and not maybe shelter a guy down just because, you know, he's a little more vocal than some of us. And when everybody's kind of playing on that edge of a little over the edge, I think we're all playing, you know, our best hockey. So,
yeah, he definitely had an impact for you guys during that run. As far as the rest of that series went, his goal in game two was all you needed. You win 1-0, go to Ottawa for game three. And that's where a big moment in the postseason happened. Ottawa kind of steamrolled you guys out of the gate there. And Matt Murray moves into the net. Marc-Andre Fleury taken out by Mike Sullivan. And from that point forward, it was Matt Murray for you guys the rest of the way. Can you take me back to what you guys were thinking, you know, in a moment like that where you just talked about it a few times, how good Flower was in getting you to that point? And then a switch is made, and it was a switch that was not just made, I think, with the sense of swinging momentum in that game, but maybe just in the sense of swinging momentum in that series and for your team. And obviously it paid off with Matt being in goal the rest of the way. But how did you guys process that as players? And or am I just making too big of a deal about it? How did it go down at ice level in that situation?
Well, it was a big change, you know, for all of us. It was a big deal, but I think it was kind of the mentality of the whole season was, you know what, like, guys are stepping in, filling in here and there. And you know, it was probably a really tough call for the coaches, I would imagine. I mean, that's not an easy deal. That had to be a really tough one. Both those guys are great goalies. Like, it wasn't an easy situation, but again, they all handled it pretty well. And obviously Maddie came in and played really well and had a couple great series after that. But yeah, I mean, it was a big moment, you know, in that playoff run. That was a huge switch.
Yeah. I think for me, it's, you know, it was kind of disappointing on our side to, you know, put our goalie in that situation, a guy that's so beloved in the locker room. And I think you always knew in the back of your mind they were going to make the switch if there was any faltering. And it was kind of like, we let our guy down and now, you know, he's out. But that being said, then Murt comes in and he makes it calm right back there. He always made the calm play. He was never kind of out of control. And so that, you know, helped our team too. Maybe you see somebody going down and not going to get play, and now you have somebody that's just as capable to go back in there and give us the fighting chance. But I think at first it was like, God, we let our guy down. But here, good thing is we have another number one in there ready to take over and help us, you know, get past these guys.
I want to fast forward to game seven. You guys would win game four, win game five, lose game six. So you go to game seven, back-to-back game sevens. This game is a game that a lot of people who – you know, follow the Penguins for years, refer to as one of the greatest games in Penguins history. Definitely one of the most exciting. I mean, you get that with the double overtime game, but what was it like playing in it? It seemed like that game was a microcosm of the series for Ottawa, at least from their perspective, that you guys took the lead twice, they responded, and they just kind of hung around. And I wouldn't say by any chance or by any stretch were they the team in control that game at any point when you look back and watch it, but they were there. And obviously it was a one shot game for a overtime and a half, essentially, Cooney, until you ended it. But what was it like playing in that game? I have to imagine that the stress level and the anxiety levels were through the roof there that night.
I thought that game was just like it was a good example of the entire series. And that's just how they played. They kind of hung around and made it hard on you. And they were okay getting outshot and spending time in their zone and just kind of waiting for their opportunity. So that was it was a different feel in that game seven. I mean, I thought we played really well. It was just, you just had to be patient and stay the course kind of. And we did a good job. And I don't know if I've ever felt better when somebody scored a goal than when Cooney put that floater in. But man, that was a great goal. It was pretty cool too, that it was Sid to Cooney. You've seen that play so many times, and Cooney did such a good job of finding that little area to get the shot. And man, from the bench, that was unreal watching that thing go in. It was one of the best feelings I've had in hockey.
Yeah, I mean, for me, you know, I obviously wasn't the top performer leading into anything. And, you know, I think one thing you always convince yourself when you're playing down the lineup was to, you know, if you ever get your chance, get out there and earn every shift you can. And I remember sitting beside Shears and Cully and always just kind of, you know, we're feeling it tonight. Let's kind of just keep doing this. And, you know, I think for the Ottawa style, you know, it was hard on them. They couldn't just sit back because we kept taking those leads. So we still had lots of chances. It wasn't like we weren't getting our chances. We just weren't scoring. They weren't, you know, getting their chances. They obviously hit posts and things like that. But, I think just for us, that was a better style. It was one game, win it and go on, whereas they wanted to sit back and control things. We found a way to, you know, get up 2-1, they score. And then for it to take that long, obviously it's a huge special moment in my life to be able to score an OT winner like that. Last goal I scored in Pittsburgh obviously means a ton to me, but it's always fun revisiting that goal and watching the celebration is something that, like Cully said, it's the, you know, greatest feeling in sports, to be able to all celebrate like that.
Jake, how'd you take all of that in?
Yeah.
Not bad for a first playoff run.
Yeah, it's another game seven. I mean, a lot of excitement. Just first one in Pittsburgh like that. The fans are very passionate and loud, and just for the game to go going back and forth, and to have it going to double overtime, you're a little nervous. And I mean, to see Cooney score that one, it definitely was relieving, and just to know you're going to the Stanley Cup Finals, pretty cool for me, and especially my first playoff run.
Yeah, that's as cool as it gets to score the OT winner to go to the final. And then you guys get to the final after, as mentioned, knocked off Columbus, Washington, then Ottawa. Out west, there's a team that knocked off the Chicago Blackhawks, the St. Louis Blues, and the Anaheim Ducks, the Nashville Predators. Wanted to ask you guys first, when I say Nashville Predators and you think back to 2017 with everything that you were hearing about them, and I'm sure, you know, like our media people, the players, when you're not playing, maybe you're paying attention to the playoffs around the league and watching games and seeing what was going on in Nashville and kind of the surge they were creating down there of excitement in the arena and everything like that. What were your first thoughts when you saw that they were going to be the opponent for that final in 2017?
I mean, throughout the playoffs, I think that's the best. You know, you're in hotels together on the road, and we all sit there and just watch the other games throughout. You know, so you see the buildup of what each team's kind of doing and how they're playing and the style they're playing. And I think we all knew that they had a great decor and a goaltending team. We weren't, you know, sure what kind of style it was going to fit against us, with them having the puck movers and guys like that on their back end. But we knew it was going to be a tough matchup for sure. Anybody that gets to the finals, you never know how it's going to go. But I think we watched their journey just as it went on, you know, in that month and a half to 2 months before playing them, for sure.
Yeah, they had a good energy around their team that year. They were good. I mean, we knew they had good D especially, and they had a great goalie. And they had been building for the last few years. And I had played in Nashville a couple years prior, the year before I got to Pittsburgh, and I was pretty familiar with their personnel. And you know, they were playing a fun, exciting brand of hockey, similar to ours, I guess. But yeah, I mean, they had with the energy in the rink and the fans and the hype around everything they had going, it wasn't a shock that we saw them. You know, as like Cooney talked about, we watched them all the way through, and they were playing some pretty good hockey and steamrolled some good teams. So it wasn't a shock to see them in the finals.
When you get to the final, you mentioned their ability to get offense from their blue line. I think it was fair to say that they were pretty fearless coming into that first game. There wasn't any hesitation within the way they approached going into game one in Pittsburgh. And they scored the first goal, P.K. Subban with a shot from just above the right wing circle, which then wasn't a goal. And it was kind of a weird flashback in a way, not necessarily the same situation, but the year before, as you guys remember, Jonathan Drouin scored for Tampa Bay in game six. You guys were on the ropes there in the Eastern Conference Final. You get a challenge from your video coach, Andy Socher. Successful. We know what happens from that point forward. In this game, you get a challenge for another offside on this goal from Subban, and obviously it negates the goal. Did you feel the swing similarly in that situation? Or was it able to kind of relax you guys and get you back into the mood of playing, I guess?
I would say anytime that you can, you know, erase what was going to be a deficit and to be able to like, all right, take a breath, guys, let's get back into this. You know, I don't think we had come out in a fury of, you know, firing a ton of pucks or having that good feeling like we should have playing at home, but maybe that's the pressures of the Stanley Cup Finals. And you know, they were a little more enthusiastic. We'd been there before and kind of feeling it out rather than jumping right into it.
One thing that was interesting about the Stanley Cup Final, specifically in 2017, was the fact that I think Nashville brought a different kind of feel to it with, you know, the whole country music scene down there, all the energy and atmosphere that we talked about, but also the catfish. And I want to ask you guys about if you remember anything from the second period where there was a dead catfish thrown on the ice. PPG Paints Arena, people saying maybe tempting fate there as far as, you know, pushing the hockey gods towards the Predators. Obviously we all know what happened, but do you remember anything about that when that fish was thrown on the ice? Anything that comes to mind, Jake?
I honestly don't even, I mean, I remember them throwing it, and I don't, we were all kind of wondering how they got it in the rink, but yeah, it's just kind of something they rallied around, and was kind of what their team was, what they came about, the catfish and all that stuff. So they definitely had a buzz around the team with the things they were doing. And I'm just glad we were able to come out on top.
I want to know where you keep a dead catfish on your body when you're coming into the rink. Where are you hiding that, Cooney? What do you think?
I think I'd put it on my good friend like you to carry it in. I would tape it to your back for sure. But
I mean, there's got to be a little smell, no? Like,
yeah, I just remember not wanting to be hit by a fish thrown on the ice. Just make sure you're not that guy that's getting hit by the fish. But
yeah,
you knew they were going to be able to get him in the rink and throw him on the ice, as you know, the octopuses that would happen in Detroit and so on. So it was just part of their story. Obviously, it was a great environment when we eventually got there to play in that that crowd and that ruckus, I guess.
Yeah, that was something special in Nashville. As far as game one is concerned, you guys jump out to that 3-0 lead after Subban's goal is negated. Then that weird stretch where Nashville kind of chipped away and you guys weren't able to generate a whole lot of offense. No shots in the second period. You went, 37 minutes without a shot on goal in game number one until Jake decided to shoot the puck in the third period and beat Pecorino off, if I recall correctly, a pretty nice pass from Cully in the neutral zone. So what do you remember about that whole stretch? I mean, that would have been weird. I think there's a clip of Mike Sullivan on the bench saying something along the lines of, can we shoot the puck, please, please? And you guys were able to there in the third, and you took the lead back.
Yeah, I remember, in the first period, we came out high after the 3-0 lead, and not sure what really happened in the second and the third there, but they chipped away and they came back to tie it. And I got a good pass from Cully coming through the middle, and I just tried to throw a puck on net through a screen, and I was lucky enough for it to beat him. So just kind of a goal, first one in the Stanley Cup final. I mean, it's a pretty special moment.
Yeah, I didn't realize it was 37 minutes. That's, but you see it happen in the playoffs. I mean, you get ahead by three and, early in the game, and it's just so natural. I mean, we had a team that's been through a lot, so you wouldn't think that would happen to us. But, I mean, you just want the game to be over. You start watching the clock in the first period, and you're like, man, we got enough goals to score. Let's just get through this game. And then, the other team starts pressing, and you can get on your heels. And I think that's what happened. But there was a huge goal by Guentzel. I remember watching that thing go in, and that was a really big one.
That game, you guys would end up winning 5-3. Nick Bonino adds an empty net goal. But I think it's fair to say, as you just mentioned, that the 37 minutes without a shot, blowing a 3-0 lead, you probably came away in that situation by thinking, all right, we didn't have our best, but we still have a 1-0 lead in the Stanley Cup final. Am I right in thinking that? And where did you guys feel like you needed to hone in on going into game two to try to hold serve on home ice?
Yeah, I think Cully, set it off. Like, you don't want to go out and expend all that energy once you have that 3-goal lead. You want to just kind of get through that game. And the roller coaster of playoffs is, if you don't, take the will from the other team, they're going to find a way to get back in. So we obviously learned our lesson, I think, at that point, that, hey, if we don't go out there and play the whole time, we're not going to have success. But, obviously Jake getting that goal really kickstarted us to get back to playing the right way and carrying that in and throughout the series, knowing that we have to, keep playing our game and not just take our foot off the pedal.
Game two was interesting also because you guys would suffer a pretty big loss, not necessarily in the game, but in the days to follow, with Nick Bonino blocking a PK Subban shot in the first period. Leaves the game, comes back, ends up playing the rest of the game, as we find out, with I think it was a broken ankle. In any event, he had a broken bone in his leg. What do you guys remember about that? I guess that's hockey tough or whatever people want to talk about with that, but he said he was kind of running on adrenaline in that moment. How impressive was that to play that game, block that shot, and kind of work through it for him?
Yeah, I mean, I think what I remember about that is when he blocked the shot, he was on the ground, he got back up to try and block another one. I mean, that just shows what kind of type of player and guy he is, and just a guy who's willing to do whatever it takes for us to win. So you're going to definitely need those guys on your team, and he's one of them that would do that.
Yeah, I mean, I think Bones, he may have had the most blocked shots of maybe any forward in the league that year. He was right up anyways, near the top. But he was so good for our team. He played so many big minutes and both sides of the puck, offensively and defensively. And, it was big for our team, the way that he stood in there and tried to battle through it. Obviously, not easy to play on a broken ankle. So, it meant a lot to the group that he would try. Obviously, we knew how important he was to what we were trying to do. And so we were all concerned for him and wanted him to play, but not possible. So guys spilled in. But yeah, it was a big deal for him to do what he did. And, you know, I mean, he wasn't afraid to get in front of anything.
Yeah, I think we all hold our breath every time somebody gets hit with a puck and they can't get off the ice, and especially in playoffs. Bones was a, you know, big part of our group too, being around and being in the locker room. I really enjoyed him and had fun with him. So he was able to, you know, manipulate our locker room, and a guy who played, you know, huge penalty kill minutes and in front of guys who are going to shoot those shots. And guys on the bench, when you see that, you hold your breath and you see him come back. So you kind of let that air out and like, all right, he's okay, you know. And then to find out later that, you know, he's not going to be able to play because it's broken. But obviously, you know, a little badge of courage to come back out there and try, like most guys do. But, you know, throughout the series, he wasn't able to keep going.
We mentioned a little bit earlier in the Eastern Conference Final, Mike Sullivan decided to change goaltenders. Matt Murray stepped in. I think the first couple games of the Stanley Cup Final were some of his most shining moments in that run for you guys, particularly in Game 2. What do you remember about how this guy was able to step into these bigger moments? I mean, he's still technically a rookie, quote unquote, with games played due to his name in the NHL, but stepping into these moments and just seeming to shine on these biggest of stages here, in this case, in the Stanley Cup Final.
He had a great ability to step in and play big games in the big moments. I mean, he was a calm guy back there, not a lot of extra movement. You know, he's just calm. He's in front of the puck. He's huge in the net. He always seemed to find a way to play really well when we needed a big game. And that those first couple of games especially, I thought he was really good. I watched some of the highlights, you know, kind of just before we had this conversation. And it just stuck out to me how many big saves he made and how easy he made them look.
Yeah, I think just his nature of walking around the locker room is to be calm. And, you know, he doesn't really get too crazy out there. And so when you see a goalie like that, everything seems to hit him and fall down. And then to make the big saves, all you're like, oh, all right, well, we got this. That's how it goes. So, you know, you always have that belief in your back end, and you need that when you're in a series like that in the finals. Your goalie's going to have to steal you one or two.
One of the big things that jumps out about Game 2 was your guys' attack to begin that third period. This is a tie game going into the third. Jake, you kind of kick-started it right away with that early goal in the third. End up scoring three goals, Guentzel, Kessel, and Malkin in 3 minutes and 18 seconds. Chase Pekka-Rinne from the game, not the first time, or not the last time, I should say, that would happen in this series. But what did that do for you guys to be able to jump out, dictate your play right there, and then obviously kind of take control of the game as a result?
Well, yeah, I think just a play off the faceoff, and Rusty made a great play, pass off the pad to me, right to me, and pretty much an open net for me for that one. So that was pretty easy. But I just think the crowd got us really going right there after that goal, and it just filtered down the whole group. And we just kept using that, and then Phil's goal, and it kept going down. So, yeah, the definitely crowd got into it, and we used that on used that momentum.
Yeah, I think I remember Gino's goal coming down, you know, the bench side and shooting it far side over his glove. It's a goal that he had scored previously against Pekka-Rinne. I think Pekka didn't really have a great record in Pittsburgh either. It was one of those things that maybe if we just stay in his head, you know, this will work to our favor. We have home ice. We're going to play four games here. But I just remember having that confidence at that point that when this guy, you know, maybe he does struggle in Pittsburgh, and that's a real thing.
So you go up 2-0 in the series, winning game two. Now you're just two wins away again. This is a situation you were in just the year before. And our next conversation, we'll talk a little bit about Nashville and going there and playing. But I wanted to ask you guys, just in the sense of this situation, being up 2-0, what's going through your minds as you get ready to go south to Tennessee and hopefully try to take further control of this series?
Well, I mean, we knew it'd be a different animal going into that building. There was a lot made of it throughout the playoffs, watching their series, you know, how loud the building was and just the atmosphere around it. So I think, you know, going in there up 2-0, we were confident, feeling good about our game, knowing it was going to be tough. You know, we played in some tough buildings over the course of the last couple of years. So we were, I thought we were pretty confident going in. We were happy with where we were sitting. Knew we could play better probably, but we were happy having the 2-0 lead heading in there and understanding that it wasn't going to be easy.
You try to tell yourself, you trick yourself into different things. You're like, oh, okay, we won two. You know, we got the momentum, but let's go down there. If we can steal one of these next two games, now we're in the driver's seat. But I don't think we were going there expecting to win, but we had a good feeling going into it for sure.
Well, 2-0 series lead for you guys through two games in the Stanley Cup Final in 2017. And when we come back for episode number two, we will look back at the final two victories for the Pens en route to that 2017 Stanley Cup Championship. Guys, really appreciate you taking the time. Hope everyone stays well, stays healthy, and looking forward to reconvening again next week.
All right. Thanks, Josh.
All right. See you later.
So that's how it all broke down through two games in that 2017 Stanley Cup Final. Penguins holding serve on home ice. They win the first two and take a 2-0 lead with them down south to the Music City in Nashville, Tennessee. That's what we'll talk to you about next when we reconvene next week for part two of this 2017 Championship Memories broadcast. I want to thank Matt Cullen, Chris Kunitz, and Jake Guentzel for taking the time. Hope everyone out there stays safe, stays healthy. I'm Josh Getzoff. We'll talk to you for part two next week. Keep it tuned on PittsburghPenguins.com and all your social media channels for the latest surrounding these championship memories.